my dear sisters and brothers, let that song sink deep inside our hearts. I have carved you on the palms of my hand. Even if your mother forget you, I will never forget you. This is a word came from the mouth of the Lord. This is a word came through the tongue of the Lord. Believe it. This is word of God. God can never lie. He is not a human being. He can never pretend. He is not an actor. He is God. One who gives promises. One who keeps promises. All his word are true. Psalm 12:6. God's word is true. It is silver refined. It's pure. So he's telling you, he's there for you. What more you need? And that reason is all enough for us to forgive and to get reconciled with one another. One more beautiful day the Lord has given us. We are transmitting from Vincent Chin Retreat Center, Entebbe in Uganda. Let us thank the Lord for all the provisions he has given us for this mission here. And as we are here today, once again, we are honored to have Reverend Father Dr. John Parangimalil, my own brother, as you know him. And he's coming up with a powerful inspiration from the Lord. This is all about the power of forgiveness. We'll be so privileged to listen to the presentation he's going to do. And towards the end, we'll also have an adoration based on this from Entebbe Vincent Chin Retreat Center, helped by our team here and with Daniel, who is our team member. Let us now begin with a worship so that the power of the Holy Spirit may descend upon Father John and descend upon each and every one of us. Wherever you are, if possible, you can stand up and join us in worship as we just worship the Lord. Use the gift of tongues, use the songs, use in any way that you want to worship the Lord. Get out of yourselves, free yourself, forget about the atmosphere. Remember the presence of God and worship him. Let him feel worshipped. Let the Lord feel that we honor him so that the power of the Lord may descend upon Father John, descend upon everyone who are going to listen to this session today. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Salabahalabandira Bahalabaria Let's commend Father John into the hands of Heavenly Father. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Amen. Mother Mary, we consecrate Father John and all of us who are going to listen to this word of God into your most holy immaculate heart. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for
us. For our sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end.
Welcome, Father John. You are most welcome. Thank you.
My dear brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ, I'm happy to be with you once again to give God's message to each one of you. I want to sincerely thank my brother, Father Dr. Anthony Parangimalil, for inviting me to share the word of God with you. The theme that I have chosen today is the power of forgiveness. Such an important theme that we all need to reflect on a daily basis. We just prayed the Our Father, where we constantly ask the Lord to forgive us as we forgive those who sin against us. I have put a sub-theme as developing a forgiving heart. or we can even say the necessity to forgive and be forgiven. For our scripture, I just want to begin with these scripture passages. First of all, from Matthew chapter 12, 14 and 15. In verse 12, we read, "And forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us." In verse 14, "Yes, if you forgive others their sins, your Father in heaven will forgive you your sins. But if you don't forgive others, your Father in heaven will not forgive your sins." So the measure in which we will be forgiven is the measure in which we forgive others. In Mark chapter 11, verse 25, "And when you stand praying, if you hold anything against anyone, forgive them, so that your Father in heaven may forgive you your sins." Ephesians chapter 4, verse 32, "Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you." I want to begin with a few incidences, few examples to begin our presentation today. First of all, there is a story told by Ernest Hemingway. The story is about a father and a son who had become estranged. The father and son had become estranged because of some quarrel. The son ran away and the father set off to find him. He searched for months to no avail. Finally, in Madrid, in a desperate effort to find him, the father put an ad in the newspaper. The ad read, "Dear Paco, meet me in front of the newspaper office on Saturday. All is forgiven. I love you, your father." The next day at noon on Saturday, in front of the newspaper office, 800 Pacos showed up, looking for forgiveness and love from their fathers. Just imagine, with the same name Paco, 800 of them showed up looking for forgiveness and love from their fathers. So imagine the hundreds and thousands and millions of people looking and searching for forgiveness from others. Here is another story about a mother who had lost her only daughter was murdered. The murderer was at first condemned to death, but later his sentence was commuted to life imprisonment. Though initially he was condemned to death sentence, his death sentence was commuted to life imprisonment. For 18 years, the bereaved mother was unable to function normally. Whatever methods she tried to maintain her equilibrium proved futile. Ultimately, she did something which relieved her of all her problems. She met the murderer in the jail and forgave him. It is only when the hatred and the resentment was gone that peace and equilibrium dawned on her. A priest from Yugoslavia related his experience. He says, "The year I was ordained, the communists occupied my hometown and murdered my mother, father, and 7 brothers and sisters." Imagine that year that he was ordained, the communists occupied his home and murdered his father, mother, 7 brothers and sisters. He admitted, "It took 5 years before I decided to forgive the man who was responsible for murdering my family. And it took almost 25 years before I returned to Yugoslavia for a visit and search for the man who had killed my family members. Upon encountering the murderer, I threw my arms around him and told him that I had forgiven him." And the priest said, "The best mass that I celebrated was the day I forgave him." What is forgiveness? Forgiveness is defined as letting go of past grudges or lingering anger against a person or persons, or even against oneself. Past grudges or lingering anger against persons, or even against oneself. It is a mental or spiritual process. It means no longer feeling angry at another person or at yourself. This could be because of a crime, a sin, an offense, an insult, a difference of opinion, an error, a mistake, or a failure. The psychologists generally define forgiveness as a conscious, deliberate decision to release feelings of resentment or vengeance towards a person or group who has harmed you, regardless of whether they actually deserve your forgiveness or not. It's a conscious effort that a person makes. Doctors and psychologists tell us that many of our pains and illnesses have a deeper cause. The cause is found in our emotions, thoughts, and feelings. It is said that our inability or unwillingness to forgive is a major factor in some of our illnesses. We find ourselves unable to forgive someone who has ruined our family, our name, someone who has humiliated us in public, someone who has robbed us of our dignity and worth, someone who has injured us in body, mind, and spirit. Imagine the story of the priest, that his whole family was murdered just before his ordination. If we keep resentment, hatred, and unforgiveness within ourselves and nourish them, we will in time become ill. It is said that unforgiveness is often called the AIDS of the soul. Now, what is forgiving and forgetting? Many people, they even tell me, Father, I can forgive, but I cannot forget. Now, both are different. We should not get confused. What is the difference between forgiveness and forgetting? Look, forgiveness does not mean that we forget the hurt, nor does it mean condoning or excusing offenses. That would be an impossibility. For our memories are not blackboards that can be erased so easily. Forgetting is a loss of memory. Forgiving is an attitude of love. So there is a difference. Forgetting is a loss of memory. You know, sometimes your memory, you cannot forget the memory. So it carries on. But forgiving is an attitude of love. We may not be able to forget, but we can forgive and not allow the negative behavior direct our lives, mangle our relationships, and stand in the way of building emotional bridges. Again, we are not expected to pretend that nothing unpleasant happened to us or that everyone we have known so far is a saint. We cannot just pretend because something unpleasant has taken place and it is a reality. We cannot switch off our brain nor forget the unloving events of our life. What we must learn is to forgive. In his book, Forgive and Forget, Louis Smithers wrote these profound words about forgiveness. When you release the wrongdoer from the wrong, you cut a malignant tumor out of your inner life. You set a prisoner free, but you discover that the real prisoner was yourself. Look, when you forgive, you are cutting a malignant tumor out of your inner life. You are setting that prisoner free. Ultimately, that prisoner is yourself. In Matthew chapter 18, verses 21 to 22, then Peter came up and said to him, Lord, how often will my brother sin against me and I forgive him? As many as seven times? Jesus said to him, I do not say to you seven times, but 77 times. The Jews of that day taught that you could forgive a brother as many as three times for an offense. But after the fourth time, there was no forgiveness. That was the Jewish thinking. Peter knew Jesus' heart of compassion. So he doubled the number and added one. Is seven times enough, Lord? He asked. Jesus replied, 77 times. Thus indicating that we should be willing to forgive an indefinite number of times. It is a number that symbolizes boundlessness. Now the word 77 is used twice in the Bible. One in the book of Genesis, the grandson of Cain. You know, Cain murdered his brother Abel. And after that, the Lord put a mark on him, But then he was afraid. Then the Lord says, if anyone strikes or anyone does anything to you, vengeance will be taken 7 times. His grandson called Lamech, one of the most wicked men, who started even polygamy, he married 2 wives. Someone struck him and he said, someone just did some small harm to him, but he took revenge by murdering him. And he told his wives that anyone who strikes me, I will take vengeance 77 times. Jesus is saying, you must forgive 77 times. That means indefinite number, countless number of times. That symbolizes boundless, unlimited number. We cannot keep counting. Of course, when we go to the parable, you will understand it further. Jesus continued the parable of the unforgiving servant, just to explain to Peter and the apostles, what did Jesus mean by this 77 times or boundless or countless, that does not keep any score of number of times of forgiving. Let's read this passage. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his servants. When he began to settle, one was brought to him who owed him 10,000 talents. And since he could not pay, his master ordered him to be sold with his wife and children and all that he had, and payment to be made. So the servant fell on his knees, imploring him, have patience with me and I will pay you everything. And out of pity for him, the master of that servant released him and forgave him the debt. But when that same servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii. And seizing him, he began to choke him, saying, pay what you owe. So his fellow servant fell down and pleaded with him, have patience with me and I will pay you. He refused and went and put him in prison until he should pay the debt. When his fellow servants saw what had taken place, they were greatly upset, and they went and reported to their master all that had taken place. Then the master summoned him and said to him, you wicked servant, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. And should not you have had mercy on your fellow servant as I had mercy on you? And in anger, his master delivered him to the jailers until he should pay all his debt. So also my heavenly Father will do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother from your heart. Dear friends, a denarius is equivalent to 1 day's wage. So that man owed him 100 denarius, which means 100 days' wage. A talent is equal to 20 years' wages. Imagine the difference between a denarius and a talent. A talent is 20 years' wages. The servant owed him an outrageous amount to his master. Not 1 talent, but 10,000 talents. Owed him 10,000 talents. Imagine 20 years' wages multiplied by 10,000 talent, 10,000 times. It is 200,000 years' worth of debt. Unimaginable. The king is willing to forgive an inconceivably large amount. But the servant is not willing to forgive a relatively small debt of 100 denarius. The king is much more angry about the servant's lack of forgiveness for a fellow servant than about his sin against the king. That's what he was so angry. And he says, this is what will happen to each of you if you refuse to forgive your brother or sister. Why should we forgive? Why should we forgive? This is the question that many times people ask. Why should we forgive? I will never forget the headline the following week in the Sunday magazine, the Time magazine. And the incident is this: 4 decades ago in 1981, there was an attempt on the life of Saint Pope John Paul II. Fortunately, the Pope survived, as we know. It was in 1981. After he recovered, he shocked the world when he made a visit to Rome's Rabibbia prison. to see the man who had attempted to assassinate him on Christmas Day. Millions watched on television as the Pope sat beside Mehmet Ali Aka, who only 2 years before had tried to assassinate him. The white-robed Pope and the jean-clad murderer, the terrorist, huddled in the dark prison cell for 20 minutes, talking in low voices that could not be heard. When the Pope emerged from that meeting, he explained, "I spoke to a brother whom I have pardoned. I spoke to a brother whom I have pardoned." And the following week, in the Time magazine, the question was there, as you can see the cover page of Time magazine, "Why forgive?" I want to consider four reasons why we should forgive. Number one, because of the influence of Satan. If you don't forgive, you are under the influence of Satan. We don't want to give Satan a foothold in our life. When we harbor anger against a friend or anyone, that gives Satan a weak spot where he can come in and drill deep into us. We don't want him anywhere near our life. So we want to forgive, because we don't want to be under the influence of Satan. In Ephesians chapter 4, verses 26 to 27, we read, "Be angry, but do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger, and give no opportunity to the devil." Satan gains more ground in the believer's life through unforgiveness than by anything else. According to Charles Stanley, all disappointment, discouragement, hostility, bitterness, unforgiveness are from Satan. The principle is the same. If we let anger fester, it leaves an opening for Satan to get into our lives. So why forgive? Because we don't want Satan to control our life. Second, for our own betterment. When we choose not to forgive, we become slaves to bitterness. We are the ones most hurt by holding on to unforgiveness. Few people realize that when they refuse to forgive another, that they are hurting themselves. We brood over the fact so much that we cannot eat, we cannot sleep, we cannot concentrate or pray or relate to others. Our very countenance has changed. Our blood pressure goes up. So who is suffering? It's we. Our enemies would dance for joy if they knew how our hatred is tearing us apart. Our hatred is not hurting them at all. It only turns our own days and nights into hellish turmoil. Nelson Mandela, the former president of South Africa and the Nobel Prize winner, he wrote in his autobiography, "Long Walk to Freedom." "As I walked out of the door toward the gate that would lead me to freedom, I knew if I didn't leave my bitterness and hatred behind, I would still be in prison." Let's repeat those words. "As I walked out of the door toward the gate that would lead me to freedom, I knew if I didn't leave my bitterness and hatred behind, I would still be in prison." And he continues. He said on another occasion, "Forgiveness liberates the soul. It removes fear. That is why it is such a powerful weapon. It liberates our own soul. It liberates us from fear." As T.D. Jakes said, forgiveness liberates a victim. It is a gift you give to yourself. Alison Nowell wrote, "Forgiveness is healing. It heals us, especially forgiving yourself." According to Dave Willis, holding a grudge doesn't make you strong. It makes you bitter. Forgiving doesn't make you weak. It sets you free. So, second point is, because it is good for ourselves. We are the ones who are benefiting for our own sake. Number three, third reason, we are not perfect either. We are not perfect either. Just imagine the case of that unforgiving servant. Okay, we may not be owing 10,000 talent, but we may be owing 100 denarii. So in we are not perfect. We are also guilty. In Ecclesiastes 7:20, there is not a righteous person on earth who always does good and never sins. Romans chapter 3, verse 23, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And Luke chapter 18, verse 19, no one is good except God alone. Curtis Sittenfeld said, we all make mistakes, don't we? But if you can't forgive yourself, you will always be an exile in your own life. So compared to the person who has offended you, their debt might be 200,000 years, but yours will be at least 100 days, isn't it? So we are not perfect. We are also sinful. We are making mistakes. So we need to seek forgiveness and give forgiveness. So we all need forgiveness and we want to be forgiven. How can we withhold from someone else that which we hope to be given by someone else? And the fourth reason is because God forgave us. He forgives us. In Micah chapter 7, verse 18, who is a God like you who pardons iniquities, pardons sins, and forgives transgression of the remnant of his inheritance? You do not stay angry forever, but delight to show mercy. In Psalms 32, verse 5, then I acknowledged my sins to you and did not cover up my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin. Colossians chapter 3, verse 13, bear with each other and forgive one another. If any of you has a grievance against someone, forgive as the Lord forgave you. One of the last things that Jesus did while he was dying on the cross, Father, forgive them because they do not know what they are doing. Luke chapter 23, verse 34. The four reasons why we should forgive. How to forgive and receive forgiveness. Now, the last section of this, I want to deal about how to forgive and receive forgiveness. I have just put three ways in which we can forgive. Number one is, in the last point also, it's more or less the same. In the first place, sit down for a few moments and recall to mind how much and how often God and other people have forgiven us. Each time we go to confession, the Lord forgives us. Each time we beg and say the prayer, I confess to Almighty God. And to you, my brothers and sisters, the Lord forgives us. God has forgiven us infinitely more than he is asking us to forgive others. The very least we can do in return is to reach out a hand of forgiveness to our brothers and sisters. So that should give us the strength. The Lord has forgiven us so much. And that should give us the strength to forgive others. The second point is, see your enemies in a totally new light. See them not as enemies, but as human beings. See them not as enemies, but as human beings. There is a scene in the novel, All Quiet on the Western Front. The war between the Second World War was on. The French and the Germans were as enemies. And suddenly, a ceasefire was declared. And so people had put down their arms. But there was this young German soldier who had still holding on to his gun. And he was hiding in a shell hole. And he saw a French soldier standing there unarmed because ceasefire was declared. But the German soldier, he took out his gun and shot him, fired bullets after bullet upon his enemy, the French soldier. The French soldier fell to the ground and the German was watching him, how he was dying. And as he looked at him, he found that his eyes all bulging out, his mouth wide open for some water, and he was gasping for breath. As he took some time to die, the German went near and gave him some water to drink. Then, of course, after drinking the water, the French soldier died. Then he wanted to know his name. So he put his hand into the pocket of the French soldier. And there was a wallet. He took out the wallet. After opening the wallet, he found there were some photographs. The first photograph that appeared in front of him was a photograph of his wife and his daughter. The wife of the French soldier and his daughter. Suddenly, the German soldier felt so emotional and he said, "Oh my God, I did not kill an enemy. I killed the husband of a woman and the father of a child." And this was the first murder that he committed. And he took out the address and wrote a letter to the wife and the daughter of the French soldier, telling them that he had killed her husband and telling the daughter that I had killed your father. And from then on, half of his salary, he would send it to the family of the French soldier. He was able to see his enemy in a totally new light. See them not as enemies, but as human beings, the flesh and blood. They also have a family. They have dependents, their wife, they have children. And that will give us the strength to forgive and to do a penance for the mistakes that we commit. The third way to forgive, the secret of getting healed is to forgive. St. Francis of Assisi, in his song, "Make Me a Channel of Your Peace," he says, "It is in pardoning that we will be pardoned." There was an incident in the life of Mahatma Gandhi during the freedom struggle. A lot of violence was there. Then a Hindu gentleman came to Gandhi and told Gandhi, "I have killed a Muslim because some Muslims killed my son. In retaliation, I killed a Muslim. What should I do now?" And Gandhiji replied, "You must adopt a Muslim boy from among the orphans," because so many Muslims were killed. "You must adopt a Muslim boy and bring him up as a Muslim in your Hindu home with all the principles of nonviolence. Bring up a Muslim boy in your Hindu home as a Muslim with all the principles of nonviolence." The secret of getting healed is to forgive. It is in pardoning that we will be pardoned. A few years back, we had a retreat in Shillong. And during our retreat, a group of singers from Shillong, they played for us, they sang for us that song of St. Francis of Assisi, "Make Me a Channel of Your Peace." I want to play for you that song because it is so heart-touching, sung by the singers from Meghalaya, from Shillong. And it is a wonderful song. I just recorded through my own mobile, but I want to share it with you.
Channel of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me bring your love. Where there is injury, your pardon, Lord. And where there's doubt, true faith in you.
Make me a channel of your peace. Where there's despair, let me bring hope. Where there is darkness, only light. And where the sadness ever joined.
Oh, Master, grant that I may never see so much to be consoled as to console. To be understood as to understand. To be loved as to love with all my soul. consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love with all my soul.
The secret of getting healed is to forgive. It is in pardoning that we will be pardoned. I want to conclude our reflection with a prayer. Dear Lord, you forgive me so often and so completely. You bring healing to my heart. Help me to be a forgiving person. Remove the pride, anger, self-righteousness, and temptation to hold grudges from me. Make me a healer, one who restores relationships, one who promotes peace, one who is truly able to love others more than myself. You ease the hurt I feel when betrayed, offended, insulted, or ignored. Let me keep the images of your humiliation on the cross and your glory on Easter morning foremost in my mind, that I may follow you faithfully as a sincerely forgiving person. Amen. Thank you and praise the Lord.
God, beautiful day for the powerful talk of Father John, Dr. John Parangimalil, my own brother. As you know, his talks are very, very powerful. It is scholarly. It has so many quotations. It has so many incidents, so many stories. Even the most beautiful singing of Lord, make me a channel of your peace. Father John, we are very grateful for your precious time for this most inspirational preaching you have done today. It was so heart-touching. It was so inspirational. And we can definitely say, Holy Spirit has really inspired Father John to preach on forgiveness. Even if you preach about forgiveness every day, the Lord once told me, that is what I need my people to do. So thank you so much for that. And we truly thank all of you for attending this. And thank you for your prayers. We can feel the power of your prayers. That's why now we are doing the Eucharistic adoration with the Blessed Sacrament exposed. Please continue to pray for us and bless us as we conclude with dedicating ourselves into the Immaculate Heart of Mother Mary. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now at the hour of our death. Amen.
May Almighty God bless all of you, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Good night.